Welcome. The goal of this video lecture is to show you how to use the YAMBO code to compute the optical properties of a material. To this end, I will use the YAMBO Quantum Mobile, which is provided on the YAMBO Wiki, and in particular version 19.09.0.6, which has installed the YAMBO version 5.0. So a few moments that the machine starts. And in the machine, you are provided, first of all, a link to the YAMBO educational section. And here I'm going to follow the tutorial which was prepared for the SECAM 2021 school. I go to the day of the school when the BSc tutorial is done, up to obtain an optical spectrum. These are the files that you need to perform the tutorials. So first, let me point out that this tutorial is in a modular version. So it's divided in different pages. And I suggest you not to directly click on the link, but better to right click and open the link in the new tab. So like that, you have the step of the tutorial you have to follow. And then you also have the main page with all the steps, so you remember at which point you are. We are going to compute the optical properties of bulk hexagonal boron nitride. And again, this part is divided in four sub-steps, which has four links. Now, before starting, let me open the terminal. And Quantum machine, the YAMBO tutorials folder is already provided for you, and I can just enter YAMBO tutorials, HBN, YAMBO, and here you see there are the core databases provided and the quasi-particle correction databases, which we are going to use. So I can right-click again, open the link in a new tab, and the first step is static screening. So we are going to compute the inverse dielectric function, the microscopic one, at omega equals zero from the response function at omega equals zero. First step, as always, we run YAMBO as it is to do the initialization of the database. And then we use the YAMBO command line to generate the input file for the screen. So the minus XS command line is needed for the static screening. You see there are a few variables in input, and in particular, the number of bands used to construct the screening and the energy cutoff for the screening. So here we use the parameters suggested in the tutorial. We are not going to use the terminator, so I remove this input variable. And after that, I can run the command, which is just the same, the previous one, removing the command line option for the input file generation and adding this J3D BSC option. So YAMBO will run the simulation and we store in this folder the databases, in particular the screen database. Now, the simulation is going to need a few moments because it has to compute the response function for all momenta Q. Meanwhile, let me point out that once you're done with that, the next step you can follow here. So you just push on next module, or which is equivalent, you go back to the previous page, you did the static screening, you can right click here and open in a new tab the next step. So as you see, the two pages are exactly the same. We can close one of the two. Follow the path that you prefer. Now, this simulation, as I said, created this NDBEM1S epsilon to the minus one static, which is needed to later compute the kernel of the BSC equation, of the BSC matrix. The kernel has the exchange interaction, which is the Bohr interaction, and the direct electron interaction, which has the Bohr interaction times the microscopic screening we just computed. So we use again the Yambo comma line to define the input file. We can use the options suggested here, which are general for any version, or since Yambo 5.0, you can also use the extended options. We generate the input file. Now let me point out that since we provide this minus J in the input file generation, also in this step, the code is going to read what is in the 3D BSC folder, and it found that the kernel was at the sex level. This is the cutoff on the exchange and the direct interaction. We put it in Rydberg, then Yambo converts it in the number of G vectors to use for the calculation. And instead, we have to change the number of bands we are going to use for the simulation. And okay, sorry, no, I was saying something which is not true. Yeah, we didn't compute yet the kernel, and we need to set the input, the cutoff for the kernel in the next step is going to read it again. But at this level, you have to set it from input. Now, the number of bands, we reduced them from 100 to just 610 because the BSC usually converts quickly with number of bands. But of course, in real life, you have to check convergence. The real nasty part to converge is usually the K-point mesh, which is now here decided by the save folder. So when you run the your ground state calculation, you pick up a defined K-point mesh. Let's run the simulation. And here it is. This time, if I check in the 3D BSC, it created the ndb.bsq1 database. So let me point out that here the database has this string appended underscore CPU0, while in the tutorial here it doesn't. And the reason is that Yambo may be compiled with different capabilities. In my case, in particular, if I check here on the IO mode, it is HDF5 IO. So it is a serial IO, and then it appends this string CPU0. Here instead, the parallel IO is likely used. In this case, the code is not going to append this string. Now we move on to the next module, BSC Solver. So if you want to follow here, we did the kernel. We are going to do the solver diagonalization. So for the diagonalization, we are going to diagonalize the excitonic matrix. The code will read the kernel provided from the previous step, from the database, the energy difference between valence and conduction, eventually corrected via some quasi-particle correction, compute the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues, which then enter the definition of the screen. So to this end, for the Yambo comma line, we use minus YD minus VQP, so solver diagonalization and verbosity for quasi-particle input variable enhanced, because we want to add quasi-particle corrections. Again, these are the standard, this is the standard comma line, but we can also use the new comma line for version 5.0 minus K solver D. So let me run the command. And this time, this is what I was saying before, I was by mistake, this time the kernel is available and it is using the input parameter. It's reading the sex kernel. So in the previous simulation, we had sex because we're specifying that in the command line. This time we didn't specify, but it's reading from the database. Now, there are also a bunch of input variable for the quasi-particle correction, all these KFN QP. And for this particular simulation, we will just need this one. So let me erase the other ones to have a bit more nicer input file. Okay, and then there are just few input variables to change. So the energy range, which I want to plot, I set it from 2 to 8 dB, the smearing, I leave it as it is. The number of energy steps, 200, and then the direction. And finally, here it suggests to uncomment this input variable so that the code will store to database the computed excitonic wave functions. So write BS wave functions. After that, I can run the simulation. Oops, let me check if I set the quasi-particle corrections, because I think I didn't. Indeed, it was 1.44, I think. Here they are. Okay, now they are set. I was forgetting that. And then I can run the simulation using this command line, which is the same as before, just removing the command line options for input file generation. The simulation is pretty quick. And if I check now the 3D BSE, now we have a new database which contains the excitonic wave functions and some output files which I can plot, in particular the one for the dielectric function. It has a bunch of informations in the header, and then a column with the energy range specified in input from 2 to 8 EV, the real and imaginary part of the dielectric function at the BSE level, and the real and imaginary part of the dielectric function at the independent particle level. So I can use new plot to plot that. I use this command. And then I get exactly the same plot, which is provided here in the tutorial. So it's a comparison between the independent particle optical properties and the BSE ones. At the independent particle level, there is a first peak at the optical gap, which is at roughly 5.8 EV. Instead, at the BSE level, there is a bound peak at 5 EV, so there is roughly 0.8 EV of binding energy with these input parameters. And of course, you need to converge the parameters to get to the real physical optical spectrum. Now the next step, BSE on top of quasi-particle corrections. So we are going to move from here to here. We are not going to use the Schisser operator this time as before, but to redo the same with the NDBQP database, which was provided. So I first exit new plot, then I run this command. It's exactly the same as before, just I'm changing the name of the input file. And this time of all the input variable, I will need these two. So I erase all the other, the first two which are needed. And I set in input the string to let YAML load the energy from the NDBQP. Now, as before, I change the energy range, let's say from 2 EV to 8. I change the energy steps. Let me put this time 2000, the direction, and I uncomment the flag to write the excitonic functions. So that should be it. I close it, and then I run the simulation. So this time, instead of applying a Schisser operator, it will load the quasi-particle corrections from this database. The simulation is again pretty quick, and now I can go to new plot and plot the outcome. So if I check first the output, here there is the previous calculation, here there is the new one. So I enter new plot and I plot the two of them for a comparison. So you see that the Schisser operator was already doing a pretty good job. With explicit quasi-particle corrections, we have some changes which are minor, but in any case may be needed in some case to get a good description of the optical absorption. Now I exit from this folder, and here I'm done with this part of the database. So if I click here, it tells me the previous module, and there is a back to the main page, which is the same, which I have opened in background. So I've done this first step of the simulation. Now I can go back again. So I've done this first one, and now I'm going to proceed to the next step. So to this end, I close the previous one, then right click here and open the second step, the analysis of the excitons. So I'm here, I recall you, I have all the information I need stored inside these databases. And this time I'm going to use YPP to do a post-processing. So first of all, let's use this YPP minus ES1 exciton sort for the Q equal one calculation, which is the one we did. And this will directly read the database and create some extra output file without needing an input file. And in particular, it will give the list of the excitonic energy sorted by energy. And then you see that for each excitonic energy, you have an oscillator strength associated, which is defined as the rotation of the independent particle oscillator via the excitonic wave function. You can eventually also plot this. It will look pretty similar to what you get directly with the optical absorption. But let's have a look to it. We set some extra option for new plot, and then we plot this file, and here it is. So basically, we have the list of energies. Some of them are dark poles, so they have zero intensity, and just few have finite intensity, and they correspond to the optical absorption peaks. Now, an extra information which you can extract is the so-called amplitudes and weights. So this is the command line. So this time, the code is going to generate an input file. And in particular, you select the states for which you want to compute the amplitude. So the excitonic states from 1 to 4, which I remember, if we look to the sorted database, correspond to these 4 numbers. So there are 2 couple of excitons which are degenerate. The first two at 4.98, and the second one is at 5.02, and in particular, this second two contains the most, let's say, the dominant peak in optical absorption. So now we have the input file, we can run the simulation. And it created these files with the weights and the amplitude. So here is a definition of what is the weight. It's just the square modulus of the excitonic wave function. So you can have a look for a given electron pair. Let's have a look, for example, to the weights of the exciton number, or let's say the number 4. And here we see that for this excitation energy, we have different contributions, and it's the most important ones are the first 4. This transition from valence to conduction, it tells us at which K point in valence and K points in conduction, it's the same, 14 and 14, the symmetry applied for the K point. And then it tells you the weight which has in this transition, and then the energy at the independent particle level. And the amplitude is just a way to get a graphical representation of these weights. So it gives you a graphical view of where are in energy the transition which are contributing to a given pole. So let's, as it suggested, pass these 2 files into a single one. Then we open a new plot. We set a couple of parameters. The x-axis is the energy range, the y-axis is the amplitude, and then we plot this file which we created from the merge of the previous two. And here it is. So we see that the exciton 3, 4, which are degenerate, are dominated by these transitions at around 4.3 eV. And then there is a second bunch of transition at 4.8 eV. And it's a combining all these transitions and accounting for by the electron exchange and interaction which by which the exciton is obtained. Now we can go on and see extra feature. One of the things is to plot the exciton spatial distribution. And this is the common line. So now we are going to select minus EW, which means we are going to plot the excitonic wave function. So in the input file, which we have a few more parameters, this time we can select the format. So if we choose X for X-Grisden format, X-Grisden is the software we are going to use, plot in 3D, then we need to set a cutoff for the grid in 3D. Here is 30 Rydberg. We have to pick up a specific excitonic state, and let's plot exciton number 3. The BSEQ index is 1, and then the number of cells. So the exciton is a block exciton, but if once we fix the position of the hole, then the position, the wave function as a function of the electronic position is not periodic anymore. So we set these parameters. This is a bunch of long numbers. Let me directly copy them from the wiki. And that's it. So we have our input file and we can run the command to plot the input file. And as before, it's the same one, just without the lowercase option for input file generation. So we run, it takes a few moments and it also tells you that it's not going to just plot exciton number 3, but it will directly plot exciton 3 merged with exciton 4, since the two are degenerate. And in input, you see you have, in output, you have both the X-Grisden format file for exciton 3 and exciton 4. So what you can do, you can launch this command with X-Grisden as a possible visualization tool. Here you see you have a representation of 2D HBN and there is the position of the hole. And then to plot, you have to do data grid, okay. And then select a value, let's try 0.03. And we say to expand to the wall structure, the wave function, submit, and this is the outcome. So this is a representation. So we see that the exciton is mostly localized on the layer where the hole it is. So we can, for example, increase a bit. We have a nicer representation of the high density part. And we can zoom in, even increase a bit, submit. And here you see the shape. Well, the wave function is quite localized around the hole, and also in the XY plane, there is, you see that it decays moving away from the hole. Here it's a bit bigger and then it's going down. And that's it. So now we can close our visualization tool. So here in the tutorial, it points out that you can use also another software, Vesta. And then there is a last step, which is telling you that you can plot also this electronal average density. Is a new feature of Yambo 5. And well, let's try. So this is the command line as before exciton wave function, but this time there is this extra option, average electronal. We are going to keep the same parameter. Now we see there is this extra input variable So we can now eventually run the simulation. We need, as always, to read the wave function. Let's read the one from the BSCQP database. And we have the new wave functions, and eventually we can plot them. Okay, so that's it for this part. Again, we are done. It was you to go back to the CECAM BSC tutorial, and we have it open in background as well. And now the last part is to solve the BSC eigenvalue problem with different numerical methods. So far we have used the full diagonalization solver, and this is what we did. And here it points out that there are order two solvers available, the IDOC one and the SLEPC one. And there is a table with a short summary on the capabilities of each solver. And you see the diagonalization is the one which provides you everything basically, but it's of course very demanding. So if you go to large matrices, it's not really a good idea. The IDOC just gives you the dielectric function, but it is well suited for big matrices. And the SLEPC is our kind of in between, because you can select a few eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and you get everything for a few of them. And you can also try to deal with big matrices. So let me follow the diagonalization solver we already did. Let me follow the Lanczos IDOC solver. So this time, instead of using this expression for the dielectric function, it will use this continued fraction, which we have explained briefly in the theoretical lectures. And to this end, instead of minus yd, this time we will use minus yh for the input file generation. Here it is, our input file. As before, we have a bunch of input variable for the quasi-particle correction. We just use, again, the scissor. So we remove all the other input variable, set the scissor operator 1.44, and then again, energy range. Smearing is okay, 200 energies. Now, in this case of the IDOC solver, the simulation is going to depend on the number of frequency points you put here, because it will affect, it may affect the convergence. And let us leave it. And then the threshold, we leave the default one for now. So we have set the input parameter. We go down and we see we can run the simulation. We now give you a new string to this simulation, which we call low. And then we also add the other one to also read the BSC matrix from the previous simulation. So it was quick, and also in this case, the simulation, and then you have this time this epsilon. So if I check, you have the epsilon and the electron energy loss computed with the IDOC solver. You can have a look, or as before, you can plot and compare with the diagonalization solver. So let's do that. New plot, and we plot the previous calculation with diagonalization and the diagonalization with IDOC. Now, IDOC solver provides the BSC solution at the last iteration and the iteration minus one. So you will get a feeling of how much it was converged. And we can do that. And here is the result we obtained. So it's pretty identical to the diagonalization solver for the first peak. And then here, there is some noise. It's different from the diagonalization. And you know that is not converged, also checking to the difference in between the n and n minus one simulation. And okay, eventually you can increase the IDOC threshold and repeat, and you will see that this time the convergence will improve. I'm going to skip this part and directly move to the SLEPC solver as the last part of this tutorial. to show you this other feature of the YAML code. Now, let me exit from here and let me point out that if you want to use the SLAPC solver, you need YAML compiled with SLAPC, and here it is the case. So if you don't have these in your configuration options, you will not be able to perform this part of the tutorial. So again, I create a new input file for the SLAPC solver. As before, I'm just going to use the Schisser operator 1.44, and then I will erase all the other input variables for quasi-particle correction, set the energy range. So SLAPC is similar to BSC, does not depend on the number of frequencies, so you can fit as many frequencies as you like. And then I set, as before, the input variable. Now, the important input variable for this SLAPC solver is the number of eigenvector you're going to use. So this SLAPC solver is going to use the same expression as the diagonalization solver. Well, it's in the cheat sheet, for example. Let me try to open it. But the sum over lambda will be limited to the number of eigenvectors you request. So yeah, let's follow what it is suggested in the tutorials. We select just four eigenvectors, and we can also pick up a target energy. So it will look for the four closest eigenvector to this target energy. So I can also address a specific region of the spectrum. Here, the maximum number of iteration, I can set it, or if I leave it as to zero, it would be the default. I can even erase this input variable. And now the input file is ready, and I can perform the simulation just erasing the option. And well, we give a new job name, so we decide to compute just for four eigenvalues. Did we set it to four? Let me check again. Yeah, here it is. So we're going to compute just four eigenvalues, and we can run the simulation. So you see it's an iterative scheme which will stop after it gets around at least four solutions. And so last step, we can plot again. So we'll go to new plot, and we can compare the output of the diagonalization solver compared to this SLAPC solver. And you see that from SLAPC, we just have information in a very localized energy range. Okay. And that's it for everything for this video. You can, of course, increase the number of eigenvector or change the energy range to get more information with SLAPC. Let me close this part. And I'm not going to discuss the part on convergence of the input parameters, which you can anyway follow by yourself. So thank you for following this video lecture. Let me close the virtual machine, stop the sharing, and thank you for following this tutorial. Bye.